Tashlich. Aharon the watchmaker didn't live on our street, but when I climbed to the highest branch of the lime tree that grew in our garden, I could see his house clearly. It was the only one in the village that had a small lawn in front of it. The shutters of Aharon's house were painted green. Flower pots stood in the windows. There were sunflowers in the garden. Aharon and his family lived on the ground floor, that is, with the exception of his daughter, Feigele. She had a room in the attic. At night, a lamp burned in Feigele's window long after the lights downstairs had been extinguished. Occasionally, I caught a glimpse of her shadow passing across the curtain. Mottl, Feigele's younger brother, had built a dovecot on the roof and often stood on the top of the building chasing pigeons with a long stick. Leon, the older boy who was studying at a polytechnic in Kharkov, rode around the village on a horse when he came home on vacation. There was nothing that that emancipated family did not possess. They had a parrot, canaries, a dog. Aharon played the zither. His wife owned a piano. She came from Lublin and didn't wear a wig. Aharon, the watchmaker, who was also both goldsmith and jeweller, was the only man in the village with a telephone in his house. He could speak to people in Zamish. I was not a native of that hamlet. I had been brought up in Warsaw. But when the war came, my parents left the city and went to live with my grandfather, the rabbi. And there we were, stuck in a village which was on no railway and was surrounded by pine forests. My father was appointed assistant rabbi. I never stopped longing for Warsaw, its streets, its trolley cars, its illuminated shop windows, and its tall, balconied residence. Aharon the watchmaker and his family represented for me a fragment of the metropolis. Aharon had a library containing books written in several languages. In his store, one could put on earphones and listen to the radio. He subscribed to 2 Warsaw newspapers, one in Polish and one in Yiddish, and was always hunting for a chess partner. Feigele had attended the gymnasium in Lublin, boarding with some aunt while she was away from home, but now, having received her diploma, she had returned to her parents. Aharon the watchmaker had been a student of my grandfather's and had been considered a religious prodigy until he had been caught reading the Bible in German translation, a sure sign of heresy. Like Moses Mendelssohn, Aharon was a hunchback. Although he had not been officially excommunicated, it was almost as if he had been. He had a high forehead, a mangy-looking goatee beard, and large black eyes. There was something ancient and half-forgotten in his gaze, for which I knew no name, and which made me think of Spinoza and Uriel Acosta. When he sat at the window of his store studying some mechanism through a watch glass, he seemed to be reading the wheels as a fortune teller does his crystal. All day his sad smile enunciated over and again, vanity of vanities. Feigele had inherited her father's eyes. She kept to herself, was always to be seen strolling alone. A tall, thin girl with a long, pale face and a thin nose and lips. She always carried 2 books under her arm, one thick and one thin. A strange gentleness emanated from her. By this time, the fashionable girls cut their hair au garçon, but Feigele wore hers in a bun. She always took the road to the Russian cemetery. Once I even saw her reading the inscriptions in the graveyard. I was too shy to talk to her. I wasn't even sure she knew who I was, since she had a way of looking over people's heads. But I knew that, like me, she was living in exile. She didn't seem ever to stop meditating, would pause to examine trees, and would reflectively stare down well shafts. I kept trying to meet her, but couldn't think of a plan. Moreover, I was ashamed of my appearance. Decked out as I was in a velvet cap, a long gabardine, and red side locks. I knew I must seem to her just another Hasidic boy. How could she guess that I was reading Knut Hamsun and Strindberg on the sly, and studying Spinoza's Ethics in a Hebrew translation? In addition, I owned a work by Flammarion and was dabbling in the Kabbalah. In the evening, when I perched on the highest branch of the lime tree, I gazed up at the moon and the stars like an astronomer. Feigele's window was also visible to me, and just as inaccessible as the sky. I'd already been matched with the daughter of a rabbi. Every day my father read me a lesson from the Shulchan Aruch on how to become a rabbi. The villagers watched me constantly to make sure that I committed no transgressions. My father complained that my frivolity jeopardized his livelihood. All I needed was to be caught talking to a girl, particularly Aharon the watchmaker's daughter. But when I sat in my tree at night, watching Feigele's window, I knew indubitably that my longing for her must someday bring a response. I already believed in telepathy, clairvoyance, mesmerism. I would narrow my eyes until the light from Feigele's lamp became thin, fiery filaments. My psychic messages would speed across the blackness to her, for I was seeking to emulate Joseph de la Reina, who, by using the powers of holy names, had brought the Grand Vizier's daughter in a trance to his bed. I called out to Feigele, trying to invade both her waking thoughts and her dreams. I wrapped a phantom net around her, like some sorcerer from the Arabian Nights. My incantations must inevitably kindle love in her heart and make her desire me passionately. In return, I would give her caresses such as no woman had ever received before. I would adorn her with jewels dug from the moon. We would fly together to other planets, and she would dwell a queen in supernal palaces. For reasons which I was unable to explain, I became convinced that the beginning of our friendship would date from the reading of the Tashlich prayer on Rosh Hashanah afternoon. This premonition was totally illogical. Probably an enlightened girl like Feigele would not even attend the ceremony. But the idea had entered into me like a dibbuk. I kept counting the days and hours until the holiday, formulated plans, conceived of the words I would say to her. Two or three times, perching among the leaves and branches, I noticed Feigele standing at the window, looking out. I could not see her eyes, but knew that she had heard my call and was searching for me in the darkness. It was the month of Elul, and every day the ram's horn was blown in the study house to drive away Satan. Spiders' webs drifted through the air. Cold winds blew from the Arctic ice cap. So bright was the moon that night and day were nearly indistinguishable. Crows, awakened by the light, croaked. The grasshoppers were singing their final songs. Shadows scampered across the fields surrounding the village. The river wound through the meadows like a silver snake. It was Rosh Hashanah, and I put on the new gabardine and new shoes I'd been given and brushed my side curls behind my ears. What more could a young chassid do to look modern? In the late afternoon, I started to loiter on Bridge Street, watching the townspeople file by on their way to the Tashlich ceremony. The day was sunny, and the sky as blue and transparent as it is in midsummer. Cool breezes mingled with the warmth exuded by the earth. First came the Hasidim, marching together as a group, all dressed in fur hats and satin coats. They hurried along as if they were rushing from their womenfolk and temptation. I'd been raised among these people, but now I found their dishevelled beards, their ill-fitting clothes, and their insistent clannishness odd. And they ran from the evil one like sheep from a wolf. After the Hasidim came the ordinary Jews, and after them the women and children. Most of the older women wore capes and gowns which dated from the time of King Sobieski. They had tiaras and bonnets with ribbons on their heads. Their jewellery consisted of gold head chains and brooches inherited from grandmothers and great-grandmothers that vibrated as the women walked. My mother had on a gold silk dress and a pelerine decorated with rhinestones. But the younger women had studied the fashion magazines, which always showed up in the village a year or two after they'd been issued, and were dressed in what they considered to be the latest style. Some of them wore narrow skirts that scarcely covered their knees, and even bobbed their hair. The ladies' tailors stood to one side, commenting on the dress of the women. They contrasted their handiwork with that of their competitors, and ridiculed not only one another's designs, but the clients who wore them. I kept looking in vain for Feigele. My sorcery had failed, and I walked with downcast eyes among the stragglers. Some of the townspeople stood on the wooden bridge reciting the Tashlich, others lined the river banks. Young women took out their handkerchiefs and shook out their sins. Boys playfully emptied their pockets to be sure that no transgression remained. The village wits made the traditional Tashlich jokes. Girls, shake as hard as you want, but a few sins will remain. The fish will get fat feeding on so many errors. I made no attempt to say the prayer, but stood under a willow, watching a huge red sun which was split in half by a wisp of cloud sinking in the west. Flocks of birds dipped toward the water, their wings one instant silver, the next leaden black. The colour of the river turned from green to rose. I'd lost everything that mattered here on earth, but still found comfort in the sky. Several of the smaller clouds seemed to be on fire and sailed across the heavens like ships with burning sails. I gaped at the sun as if I were seeing it for the first time. I had learned from Flammarion that this star was 1.5 million times as large as the earth and had a temperature of 6,000 degrees centigrade on its surface and hundreds of thousands in its interior. Everything came from it. Light, warmth, the wood for the oven, and the food in the pot. Even life and suffering were impossible without it. But what was the sun? Where did it come from? Whence did it travel, moving in the Milky Way, and also with the galaxy? Suddenly I understood why the pagans had worshipped it as a god. I had a desire to kneel and bow down myself. Well, could one be certain that it lacked consciousness? The guide to the perplexed said that the heavenly bodies possess souls and are driven in their orbits by ideas, emitting a divine music as they circle. The music of the spheres now seemed to mingle with the twittering of the birds, the sounds of the coursing river, and the murmur of the praying multitude. Then a greenish-blue shimmer appeared on the horizon, the first star, a brilliant miniature sun. I knew that it had taken years for the rays from this fixed star to reach my eyes. But what were rays? I was seized by a sort of cosmic yearning. I wanted to cease existing, and return to my sources, to be once again a part of the universe. I muttered a prayer to the sun. Gather me to you. I'm weary of being myself. Suddenly, I felt a tug at my sleeve. I turned and trembled. Feigele stood next to me. So great was my amazement that I forgot to marvel. She wore a black suit, a black beret, and a white collar. Her face, lit by the setting sun, shone with a Rosh Hashanah purity. "Excuse me," she said. "Can you locate the Tashlich for me? I can't seem to find the place." Her smile seemed to be saying, well, this was the best pretext available. In her gaze, there were both pride and humility. I, like Yosef de la Reina, had summoned my beloved from the Grand Vizier's palace. She held in her hand a prayer book which had covers stamped in gold. I took one cover of the book and she grasped the other. I started to turn the pages. On one side of the page was Hebrew and on the other Polish. I kept turning the leaves but couldn't find the prayer either. The crowd had already begun to disperse and heads kept turning in our direction. I started to thumb through the book more quickly. The Tashlich prayer just could not have been omitted. But where was it? Feigele glanced at me in wonder, and her eyes seemed to be saying, "Don't get yourself so wrought up. It's nothing but a stratagem." The letters tumbled before my eyes. The prayer book trembled as though it were living. Inadvertently, Feigele's elbow and mine touched, and we begged each other's pardon. The prayer seemed to have flown from the book, but I knew that it was there, and that my eyes had been bewitched. I was just about to give up looking when I saw the word Tashlich printed in big, bold letters. "Here it is," I cried out, and my heart seemed to stop. "What? Thank you." "I haven't recited the Tashlich myself," I said. "Well, suppose we say it together. Can you read Hebrew script?" "Of course." "And this prayer symbolizes the casting off of one's sins into the ocean." "Naturally." We stood muttering the prayer together as the crowd slowly moved off. Boys threw mocking glances at us. Women scowled, girls winked. I knew that this encounter was going to get me into a great deal of trouble at home. But for the moment I revelled in my triumph, a sorcerer whose charms and incantations had worked. The look of religious devotion on Feigele's face made her appear even gentler. The sun had already disappeared behind the trees, and in the distance the forest looked blue and like mountains. Suddenly I felt that I'd experienced this moment before. Had it been in a dream or in a former life? The air was alive with sound, the croaking of birds, the buzzing of insects, a ringing as if from bells. Frogs began their evening conversation. A herd of cows passed nearby, their hooves pounding the ground. It was a miracle the animals didn't drive us into the river. No longer did the book tremble in our hands. I heard Feigele murmur, "The Lord looketh from heaven. He beholdeth all the sons of men. He fashioneth all their hearts alike. He considereth all their works."